Okay, so we are going live now. Jyoti Prakash, I would request you to go with the formalities of the session.
Yes, thank you, Devasis. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Jyoti Prakash Datta, co-founder, Team Lex Cognoscenti. We welcome you all to this edition of Lex Cognoscenti's Trended Web Series. So before we start with these proceedings or with this interview, and before we go to introduce our guest, I would let you all know about the basic purpose behind this Trended Web Series. So we have started this Lex Cognoscenti's Trended Web Series so as to let everyone know about the legal personalities and their vast experiences in the legal field. So we always believe that experiences should not be sold to anyone, because it cannot be sold to anyone. So we always try to get the best of the experiences from each and every guest that we invite, and to give it to all the viewers free of cost. So today we are joined by Mr. Surya Sundar Das. He is a senior advocate, Odisha High Court. We are pleased to have him on board today. So I will join this session in the second phase to put some question to our honorable guest. And now I would request Devasis Kumar Panda, our co-founder, to take over this session and to introduce our honorable guest to all our viewers and to start with the first phase of questions. So Devasis, please.
Thank you, Jyoti Prakash, for succinctly introducing our venture, namely Lex Cognoscenti, and its purpose behind doing this particular rendezvous series with our guests. So good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, all the attendees. Today we have with us senior advocate Surya Sundar Das, who is an eminent advocate and has been practicing since almost 4 decades in Orissa High Court and various other high courts and other forums regularly throughout the India. He has a mammoth and elephantine experience in this professional legal field, and even he has bagged a number of awards, and one of them that I can remember is Nyayo Jyoti Award, which has been given to him. Apart from this, he has assisted a number of senior lawyers, number of senior advocates who are of national repute, like late Honorable esteemed Soli Sarabji, K.K. Venugopal sir, Ramaswamy sir, A.M. Singhvi, P. Chidambaram, Harish Salve, and a number of senior advocates of national repute in a lot of cases. He basically practices in Orissa High Court, however, has his base all over India and visits a number of courts, forums for different type of cases in engagement and direct basis. He has a number of leading cases to his name, which we will surely unearth in this particular interview while we question him on that particular thing. Now, in this particular session, we will get to know about his life, his struggles, his legal profession, and the leading cases and manifold lesser-known anecdotes and advices for young generation. So, I would request all the attendees to stay tuned with a person who is having an experience of almost 4 decades. So, with the due permission of Surya sir, we will like to start with the initial questions that I have.
Yes, please go ahead. And very nice
Thank
to have
you.
such an introduction from you. And I also welcome all the those who have been participating in this particular what do you call it a discussion rather.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. So the first and very foremost basic question that we all want to know from you is about your schooling and childhood days.
Well, I was born on 3rd of March 1960, but my date of birth has been registered as 3rd September 1960. It is because most likely at that point of time, because of certain age barrier, admission to schools were a restricted zone. That is the reason most likely my age has been reduced by 6 months. And I am born in a family which has a wide range reputation in the state of Odisha. My father is late Sri Satya Sundar Das, who was known as Tiki and a famous football player of the state of Odisha. My mother is Ajapa Das, and my grandfather is Utkala Prano, Brother Sundar Das. He is one of the few who had a lead role in making Odisha a separate province in the year 1936. I am fortunate to be born in that family, and my schooling was done in a school which has been named after my grandfather. It is Brother Sundar High School, and I passed out matriculation in the year 1976 in first division. And prior to that, in class 7, there was a board examination conducted, and I had stood first in Katak 2 circle, and I was receiving scholarship also. After having passed matriculation from Brother Sundar High School, I had my intermediate from Stuart Science College, and thereafter graduation from Devonshire College, and completed my LLB from Madhusudan Law College. Thereafter, I had taken admission in the LLM course in the Madhusudan Law College, but couldn't pursue that because at that point of time, I had already enrolled myself as a lawyer and had joined the office of a great legal luminary in the state of Orissa, late Sri Ramakanta Mahapatra, and I was also playing for the state at that point of time in a game of badminton. So all the three things could not be pursued together, for which I had to drop LLM and had to pursue my legal profession and badminton career.
Thank you so much, sir, for informing about your bright and grateful childhood and your schooling and law school life. Now, as we all know that there is a recent trend between students to join law school, and they mostly decide this particular thing of doing law after their boards, after they either fail in engineering, medical and any other line, and after that they decide to choose law. So this brings me to ask you a very basic question, that at what point of time you decided to take up law as your career?
No, it is in fact not correct. What you said, it was having 30 to 35% at that point of time. And we had few law colleges having few seats also available at that point of time. And when I studied law, myself and 4 or 5 of my friends, I can name them, Mr. Amir Kumar Mishra, who is the additional government advocate now, Mr. Ajit Dharanjan Das, who is also an additional government advocate now, Mr. Vivek Mahanti, Mr. Vivekananda Bhuya, who was also an additional government advocate. We all were studying with the intention to have to take it as a profession. We never had studied law as an alternative because we could not be successful anywhere else. We had the intention that yes, after the graduation, we will take up law and we will study for 3 years, and thereafter immediately we will enter into the legal profession that we did. But in fact, what happened at that point of time is, you know, in 60s, 70s, on just asking, you could get an employment. But thereafter, the employment became a difficult, proposition for anyone to get into. That is the reason, in the quest of employment, why should someone waste his precious period in the life, younger stage? That is why they were prosecuting studies, and prosecuting law studies. And while they were prosecuting law studies, they were preparing for employment. It is not that they could not be successful anywhere and they came to the legal profession thereafter. It's absolutely wrong notion. I'll tell you one thing, when I studied law, in fact, there are many people within the family which did not want me to study law, because they said, that is a saying in Odia, I am saying it will translate in English. Then it was very much prevalent. It means that whoever doesn't have any other vocation, then he enters into the legal profession. But I wanted to give it a different color. It is like, that means those who have got real wisdom, the real thing in them, they come to this profession. And that is how we have come. We have never come like Anyagati, we have come as Bhattigati. And now I'll tell you another thing also, since this particular question has been raised by you. You see, earlier, during the time when we studied law, entered into profession, about one or couple of decades before that, you see, legal profession was a dignified profession, and whoever was a lawyer, he was kept in a very high esteem. They had the highest level of intellectuals available anywhere in the country. But a time came, I think it was only hardly 10, 15 to 20 years. During that time, in fact, its position got degenerated. I don't know why. What was the reason? Of course, I can't make out now. In the hindsight also, I have never thought of finding out the reason for that. Because, you see, what is paramount, the way I consider is, don't get caged by your past. You live with the present and be an architect of your future. If in the hindsight we try to find out as to why such things were happening and why genuinely people were not getting interested to study law, then I'll be getting myself caged in my past, which I don't want. I want to live with the present. That is, yes, I am a lawyer and I have been designated as a senior lawyer. And also, I want to be an architect of a future to find out tomorrow what I am to do.
Very well portrayed, sir, regarding this particular question as to how and when you have decided law and what is the trend that is going on right now.
Another thing I missed here when you put me this question. Well, initially, in fact, I had not the intention of studying law. After passing out matriculation, when I took up my science intermediate course in Instructions College, I was having in my mind to be in the legal in the medical profession. I had appeared in the interview but could not succeed. When I could not succeed, then and there, of course, I decided to come to this line, for which I switched over to BCom. But I'll tell you an interesting factor at that point of time. What happened? Why was I not interested for law for those initial years? Period. My friend Amir Kumar Mishra was also a former state player in badminton and now is the additional government advocate for the last 20 years. His father, late Mr. Srinivas Mishra, was one of the leading lawyers at that point of time. If anyone was to think of who a better lawyer in revenue law, in endowment law, then definitely one would jump into the office of Mr. Srinivas Mishra. He is no more, of course, late Mr. Srinivas Mishra. So what happened is, in fact, Amir Mishra's mother and my mother, they are also classmates. My maternal grandfather and his maternal grandfather, they are also colleagues in Khordha High School. And my grandfather was the headmaster and he became a headmaster thereafter. So there was a family bonding, in fact. So I used to visit to their house quite often. In the morning, if I visit to his place, Uncle Mishra would be sitting in the office. In the afternoon, you go to his place, you'd be doing some yoga and also gardening. In the evening, in the office. At night, in the office. So I was never seeing late Mr. Mishra anywhere else other than the office. I thought, what kind of human being he is? Every time you visit, he's in the office with the books, with the clients, and no time to come. At 10 o'clock at night, Mausi used to go and call him for dinner. He would come, and that is the time you could see him. So that was a factor which was working against to become a lawyer. But that was done away with very soon once I entered into the profession.
That's an interesting story to know from you about how you took up law as your career. Now, as we know that your grandfather, brother Sundar Das, and your father, Satya Sundar Das, were not in a legal profession. So I would like you to know that whether there was someone from your family who is or was in legal profession and has inspired you in some way or other.
No, there was none in our family as a lawyer, but my uncle Pisa, my youngest Pisa uncle, Pupa, so he was a practicing lawyer in Khordha, but had a very little impact influence upon us. My mother has a very important role to play for me being a lawyer. While after passing out graduation, then I was a state champion in badminton, and I was given appointment in Steel Authority of India, then in Reserve Bank of India, and in the postal department. But my mother didn't want me to join in those posts. She wanted me to be a lawyer. And we since had a vast estate. After the estate's abolition, my mother has seen my father, in fact, toiling after cases to get success. And that is the reason probably my mother wanted me to be a lawyer. And apart from that, my elder brother, just immediate elder brother, who is staying in California now, he had helped financially a lot at the initial stage when there was a difficulty to earn even 100 to 200 rupees a month. So this is how I got inspiration from my mother, from my elder brother, and from my other three brothers, especially my younger brother, who was always with me as I would say, the shadow of mine.
Rightly said, sir. Even we always consider that there is always a woman behind a successful man, and in your case your mother played a very important role in pushing you through law, pushing you to take up law as your career. So that's quite interesting to know that. And now this brings me to ask you another question, that as you just now said that late Srinivas Mishra, you used to visit him. So was he your inspiration for taking up law, or whether it was your, as you said, your uncle or anybody else whom you looked up to for taking up law as your career?
No, as I said, Srinivas uncle was a negative factor initially. But that negative factor got translated to positivity after I entered the law classes. See, when there was a difficult topic, in fact, we were confronted with while attending classes, I used to be in my friend's office in the evening. After completion of badminton, we used to sit at his office. They have a clerk, he is Christoph Heiner, who is more than a civil court lawyer. And there are three other lawyers in that office who were quite senior to us, but very friendly with us. And so any difficulty we were getting confronted with in our law classes, we are getting those things discussed in Mosa's office, in uncle's office. And if at all, his associates, Christoph Heiner and my friend Amir, we were not in a position to bring out a solution to the problem we were confronted with. Ultimately, we are going to uncle, and we used to ask him, this is the problem, what is the solution? Can you believe, by that time, he was an established lawyer having roaring practice. Irrespective of that, even if there is a problem we have been confronted with belonging to his field, to uncle's field, if we go to him, ask him a problem, he first used to take us to the textbook, to every section. Though every section must have been or might have been imprinted in his memory, still then he used to take us to every word, to every preposition in the particular section, and he used to make us understand what is the section, what the section wants to in fact portray, how do you read the section conjunctively, disjunctively, and these are the things which are nothing but just arithmetic. And since we were sportsmen and we were playing methodically, so this methodical in fact explanation which was given to us by Srinivas uncle, that translated the negativity into positivity. And he was definitely an inspiration to me.
Indeed, sir, even as you portrayed him, that he has a trait to go back to books, even he is having all those sections, all those rules imprinted in his mind. That's a very good trait, as you pointed out. And I can imagine that how that particular thing would have impacted you in turning your negative aspect of him into positive side for taking up law. So as you said us that you were studying in Madhusudan Law College. So this brings me to ask you a question as to how was your law college at that time, and how was your experience studying in your alma mater? Because this studying of law has changed tremendously since your time.
Well, The answer is very simple. Whoever was studying law with the interest to practice, he was very serious in the class. That alma mater, you know what is the meaning of alma mater? We all speak about it. It means a nourishing mother. So that college was really a mother for us. Can you believe? In those days, our classes were full with students. I am not exaggerating. And it is not as is being projected by many. So then also in 1981 to 1983, that is the period when I studied law, our classrooms are full. And the teachers were taking the classes with real zeal. Not that they were just coming for the heck of coming to the college. They were studying, they were teaching with zeal, and we were also interacting with our teachers. But now what has happened? I'll tell you, there is a difference between the study and the students at that point of time taking law as a profession and now taking it as a profession. The question is, at that point of time, legal profession was absolutely in its correct place and space. Like, lawyers were absolutely disciplined, courtroom was absolutely disciplined, judges not only, I would say, exceptional, but also the court atmosphere was such wonderful. If there was a monotony in the court, the monotony was being broken by the judges themselves. Why to monotony? Just create an atmosphere to work inside the court. So in that kind of situation, the law practice was being looked into at that point of time. So those are lucky. Those are the lucky people who at that point of time studied law with interest and had come to the profession to be a lawyer. Now what has happened? And then I want to emphasize upon this. Anyone who was studying law then had only two options open, either to be a lawyer or to join the judicial service. Now the service, in fact, atmosphere is such that everywhere a lawyer is wanted as an employee. But then a lawyer was desired, not wanted, was desired as an employee in a judiciary. And the others, they are coming to the legal profession. There are only two branches. So anyone who was serious to be in the litigation, you are becoming a lawyer. And who wanted to serve the society by going to the other side of the coin, they were becoming the judicial officers. Now, so then, the very approach to law was different. Now you see, after the coming to being of the integrated law courses, it is 5 years. That is, you come out with a graduate and a law graduate together. So there, during our days, we were first graduates, and then after 3 years, we are becoming law graduates. Now it is a combo. After 5 years, you come as a graduate and also law graduate. And whoever now comes as a graduate and law graduate, the employers at various level, they are keeping eye over as to who could serve them better, who could they pick them up at the very threshold level, and who could they rear up and build up to, in fact, help them in the future. So they take few law students at the very threshold in the campus selection to join as employees. So some young lawyers, they go in a campus selection. Then now when few go on in the campus selection, other few who wanted money instantly, they wanted to join somewhere. So they were searching for the corporate. So wherever there was a chance to enter into corporate, they enter into corporate. And then the rest, they are the cream in my assessment. They are the cream in the sense they were coming for the profession. And those who were picked up at the college level or who were joining the corporate, well, initially they are much better. But later on, over a period of time, they would be coming with abuse to what Gujarat litigation and calling, sir, please help me out. Right? So practice, the entire approach to the legal system has changed. And what I told you about the court, in fact, atmosphere at that point of time, now the court atmosphere is totally different. Then the seniors, there are hardly any designated senior advocate. During our time, I believe, till the time when my senior, late Praveen Pali, late great Ranjit Manti, Gangadhar Rath sir, SS Basu sir, when they were disturbed with the honor of senior advocate, by that time only a couple of firsts were senior advocates. I think Mr. Vijay Manti was the senior advocate, and one Mr. D.P. Manti, they were the senior advocates. Only, and Mr. Govindas was the senior advocate. Only they could be counted in number. But even if my senior Praveen sir, SS Basu sir, they were not senior advocate designated, but they were more than the senior advocates. Every member in the bar who are younger to them used to pay them respect, and at the same point of time, there was adequate reciprocation from their end. There was so much of love and affection from them toward the younger generation. But now what is happening, there is a race to become a senior advocate. Then the senior advocates who are being picked up, they are being requested to come to become a senior advocate. Now there is a race to become a senior advocate. You have to apply. And then the latest judgment of Indira Jai Singh versus Union of India, the Honorable Supreme Court of India has said as to what would happen, what would be the procedure for appointing or bestowing the honor of senior advocacy on a particular lawyer. And there the Supreme Court discussed about various aspects being followed in various states in our country, and the conformance of senior advocacy in various other countries, then came out with certain guidelines how a senior advocate is, how the honor is to be bestowed. Now see how there is a sea difference. There they are being requested. Now you are to request to become a senior advocate. That is the difference. And now, in fact, another basic difference is that respect toward the seniors, what was prevalent then, what was the rule by them, has become an exception nowadays. And with due humility, I would not shirk away from my responsibility to bring it to this august audience today. A new culture has gradually crept in, that is a crab culture, which was never there. Then I'll just give already disclosed that I would definitely say few anecdotes what happened during my younger age as lawyers. Now this is the right time to say 2-3 anecdotes, right? Once in my senior's office, there was no restriction for a younger lawyer in his office to file independent cases. So we were privileged to file independent cases being associates of his office also. There was no bar. So initially from Jaipur area, in fact, I was getting a good number of cases. Once a case matter came, I still remember that was a case where the question was, could the executing court go behind the decree, or could the executing court in a given circumstance be allowed to explain away the decree? So the principle is that the executing court cannot go behind the decree. So in that case, I still remember, it was in 1987-88. I was fighting a battle by saying that, oh, here is the executing court which has explained a decree and has gone beyond the decree and has literally set aside the decree, which not within the jurisdiction. My opposition was late Mr. Sudam Sahu. He was the government pleader at that point of time. And it was before Honorable Justice Sarachandra Mahapatra. I was arguing the matter. Then Honorable Justice Mahapatra had put this question to Mr. Sudam Sahu, late. He is my sir's friend, classmate. they, what is your answer? Then Mr. Sahu probably had no answer to that. At that point of time, a very elderly lawyer, Mr. R.N. Sinha, I think at that point of time, he was the eldest practicing in the Odisha High Court. He was just trembling while coming to the court, but very sharp. He stood up and told the court that a judgment of Supreme Court has come, which has been reported in 1982 Supreme Court. Incidentally, I have read that judgment. I have prepared that case before coming to the court. If with the understanding, if such a, I am confronted with that judgment, I would in fact try to explain. He said that 82 Supreme Court, you can note down the judgment, that was on section 22, subsection 2 of the specific relief act. And judgment is AIR 1982 Supreme Court, page 818. He showed he from his side, though he was not in the picture in the case, he of his own stood up and said, my lord, this is the latest judgment of Supreme Court on that. Justice Mahapatra took the book, read it, and then told me, Mr. Das, read this judgment, come prepared again. I said, I'm ready with the judgment. Instantly, see, I was only 3 years to 3.5 years old in the practice. Yes, 3.5 or 4 years old in the practice. I said, sir, my lord, I'm prepared with the judgment. I explained, I clarified. I tried to, in fact, distinguish the judgment as not applicable. Ultimately, I lost the case. But you know what happened? That was discussed among the judges. That was discussed among the senior members in the bar. And then another senior lawyer who was designated senior along with me, but very senior, Mr. Puranjan Roy, he is no more. He went and he discussed this matter the way I presented in the High Court Bar Association Hall. And then the next day, Mrs. Amya Kumari Padi, who ultimately became a judge of the Odisha High Court, she told me, Surjo, did you argue a matter before Sarath Bhaina? Because Justice Mahapatra was her brother, cousin. I said, yes. Now, you argued so well, it was discussed in the Bar Association. So that was the kind of, in fact, I would say, the relationship between the senior advocates then and the younger lawyers then. Now, if a younger lawyer does well, nobody recognizes. There is no discussion in the bar. Nobody ever tells him, well, well done, give a pat on the back. Nothing. But I do. Because what I have received, I want to pass it on to my younger generation. This is one incident. Another incident, it was a, see, if there is a, in fact, I can't express the feeling what is that is getting generated inside me. It was a matter before Honorable Justice R.C. Patnaik and Honorable Justice Sarath Chandra Mahapatra. It was regarding the change in the policy in Orissa mining, so service condition, change in the service condition in the Orissa Mining Corporation P&A rules without taking resort to the provisions of the Workman Compensation or Industrial Disputes Act. I was arguing the matter. It was morning court and the courtroom was packed. Honorable Justice Mahapatra had been putting me questions left and right. I was trying the best to answer to satisfy his lordship then. After 15 to 20 minutes, Mr. Arthabandhu Mishra, the former he is a senior advocate and former standing counsel central government, he stood up from all the whole of the members in the courtroom and told, Manas, a young lawyer has been able to hold the court for 15 minutes in admission matter. Is it not a fit case for admission? Justice R.C. Patnaik, admit. See, this is what was the, in fact, relationship between the elder lawyers, younger lawyers, bench, and the bar. And another anecdote in regard to this, then we'll skip over to the other thing. It was hardly four or five, the two more things I will say. It's hardly 4 or 5 months in my practice. There was a case of appeal against acquittal. It was to be argued by my senior, late Mr. Ramakanta Mahapatra. And this case was concerning Cattle Trespass Act. In a Cattle Trespass Act, when there is an acquittal order passed by the trial court, under the sun, no appellate court will ever interfere, grant leave for an appeal to be filed against that particular acquittal order. But it was before Honorable Justice Dr. B.N. Mishra. And my senior, when the matter was called out, my senior told Honorable Justice Mishra, my young friend will do it. It was only 5 to 6 months in the practice. I argued. I still remember for about most likely 7 to 8 minutes. Justice Mishra was known as one of the most disciplined judges of Odisha High Court then. Gave me a very, very patient hearing. And after giving me a hearing, he said, well done, young gentleman. I am dismissing your case. Then when sir came inside, he told sir, your young friend had done exceedingly well, but you know the fate of the case. This was a reply from the response from the court. In another case, I was engaged by it is an amicus curiae for the main accused person. The offences were under Section 395 IPC, deputy. For the principal accused, Mrs. Padhi was appearing then. I was in amicus, so I just inquired as to who the principal lawyer. So it came to know my notice that Mrs. Padhi is the principal lawyer. Then I went to her. Her residence office is just behind our residence in Cuttack. I went to her, gave my identity. Then she said, I know you. Then I said, everyone used to call her Ma. But I used to call her Mausi. I said, Mausi, in fact, I am here along with you in this case at amicus curiae. Then she said, okay, you prepare the case. And she left an instruction to her clerk that as long as Sorjo is there, keep the office open. Can you believe the Bashis? I used to stay, work in the office, in her office till 4 o'clock in the morning. And then she said, have you prepared? I said, yes. Make a note. Then I made a note. Then she was totally satisfied with the preparation. Then she told me, if the case comes before the Chief Justice, the Chief Justice then was Honorable Justice, the first Chief Justice from the outside, from Assam. I can recollect his name. The Chief Justice after Justice Ranganath Mishra. Honorable Justice Dambardhar Pathak. Chief Justice Dambardhar Pathak, Mrs. Padhi said, well, Sorjo, if the matter comes before Chief Justice Pathak, then she would argue. But if the matter would come before Honorable Justice B.K. Behra, then you would argue. Luckily, the matter came before Honorable Justice B.K. Behra's division bench. So I was given the opportunity. I argued. And I cited a judgment, I remember, AIR 1932 Lahore. Then Justice Behra asked me, yes, Mr. Young Counsel, you couldn't find a better judgment, decent judgment. You know, before I could answer, Mrs. Padhi stood up and said, my lord, I have seen him prepare this case and there is no other judgment other than that. Ultimately, he asked me to give a written notes of submission. I submitted with the endorsement of Mrs. Padhi, Mausi, and there was an order of acquittal. So this was the relationship between the seniors and the younger generation.
That's quite great to hear these anecdotes portrayed by you for this question particularly. Even if you ask me honestly, I envy that why I was not born at that time and I haven't started practicing then. Because we don't know if we will get to experience all these holistic things between the bench, bar, seniors and everyone around in this particular legal field as you have received. So much love and care and attention and everything. Of course, because of your hard work and clearly intent wait, but then I don't know if we will receive all these things. So I clearly envy on that particular thing, but it's quite a great thing to know from you, the great justices, great lawyers, senior advocates from you, and we this will surely help our audience to know the history and who were the legends doyen of the bar at that time and who were the great justices who used to love their seniors, love who is arguing before them and everybody. So that's clearly a fantastic answer, sir. Now, as you were saying about senior advocates and Indira Jaisingh's case, even today a judgment came from Orissa High Court, that is Bansidhar Bog on versus Orissa High Court Registry on this appointment of senior advocate thing.
3 days back.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So I would like to point this out for our audience that they can also read this particular judgment. It is available in Live Law. And Orissa High Court has clearly portrayed about appointing of senior advocates in Orissa High Court, which will surely help them if they want to refer it in their further cases. Now, as you said that you were a fourth year student during your time in Madhusudan Law College, I wanted to know that what all were the fields of law that fascinated you. As you said, Srinivas Mishra sir was doing endowment and then revenue cases. So were those subjects near to you, or are there any other subjects that fascinates you?
No, those subjects were never nearer to me. I also didn't want to go near those subjects because every section you want to read, that was creating a boredom in the mind. So at a younger age, in fact, you want interesting cases. You want to be to enter into a profession where you yourself will be getting excited and you will be getting a zeal to work, you will be motivated to work. If someone would like to go into revenue laws, endowment laws at the very threshold of his career, then he would lose interest because every section that needs a 3, 4, 5, 6 times read. Otherwise, you will not make out any sense from the section itself. It was really boring at the initial stage. So what was more interesting at the initial stage for me was the criminal law and Hindu law. And the teachers who were teaching us the criminal law, like IPC, Mr. D.P. Mohanty, Mohanty sir is no more. He was a jovial teacher in IPC. I wonder if at all such a teacher is available in the Indian Penal Code, now in the present days also. Wonderful teacher. And Hindu law was being taught by Mr. The Bengali teacher. In fact, it is about 40 to 1 years back. Instantly not coming to my mind, but he was a very good teacher in Hindu law. So these are the two subjects which were dragging us to the law college quite sincerely at the very threshold stage.
Yes, sir. Even most of the students tend to bend towards Hindu law and criminal law as they seem to be interesting to them and were taught to them in their initial years. So, yeah, very absolutely correct. And even for me, criminal law is quite fascinating. And I have started reading CRPC and evidence from my first year. And even read those things now and even participate in trial advocacy competitions. So even I am quite bent towards criminal law.
Devashi, since you said, you told about the CRPC and Evidence Act, another anecdote before Justice Sarat Chandra Mahapatra. So he was sitting single, and on that particular day, my senior did not want to do a case after lunch. Probably he had some other important cases fixed or he had to go somewhere. I don't remember exactly what was the situation. So he wanted me to speak for an adjournment after lunch. But in the meanwhile, during the lunch, he had gone and requested the Honorable Judge that he won't be available after lunch. So his case be adjourned. But one of the members from the office would be making a mention. So that was in fact not known to me. Because I couldn't have interaction with sir after the instruction given in the morning in the office. So when I made a mention, Justice Mahapatra said, you are making a mention for adjournment. You know what has happened subsequently? I said, yes, sir. Out of fear, I said, yes, sir. Then said, what? Then he said, tell me what? Then I kept mum. Of course, I didn't know. Then I just wanted to murmur something by someone prompting me from the behind. Then he said, oh, it is hearsay. And tell me, where is in the CRPC there is hearsay evidence? The Vashis, you can't believe the court, in the courtroom, ACs were functioning with full flow. And CRPC and then hearsay evidence. I couldn't correlate. Then after 2-3 minutes, when Justice Mahapatra could realize, as sweating is coming from the forehead, he said, young lawyer, you should apply your mind. Why you become immediately tense? When something is put to you, apply your mind. How can hearsay evidence be in the CRPC? It has to be in the Evidence Act. It can't be in CRPC. So these are the kind of things we are learning then from the judges at that point of time.
That's an interesting story on this particular thing, that we should be keep ourselves present in the court and hear and listen to the questions put forth to us, so that we can answer in a witty manner. Absolutely. Very interesting story pointed by you. So, sir, next thing that comes to my mind is about moot courts, which are getting traction nowadays. And even I have personally appeared before you in one of the moot courts happened in Madhusudan Law College. So I know that you have judged a number of moot courts. So with that, I would like to know the importance of moot courts in the present day scenario, that which plays a great role in shaping a good legal career, if any.
Yes. During our days, it is not that the moot courts were not being held. Moot courts were being held, but not as frequently as is being done nowadays. You know, moot courts are a platform by which the younger generation of lawyers who aspire to be the lawyers or to be in the legal field, they get acquainted with, I would say, it's a rehearsal sort of thing. So how do you prepare a case? How do you present yourself before a court? And how do you act or react to the questions or the clarifications sought for by the judges? In the process, you get tuned to a particular sort of thing. So immediately after passing out law, if you join a litigation and if you are supposing getting a case to argue, then preparation of a case will not be something new for you, because you are used to that over a period of 5 years. And over a period of 5 years, you might have in fact participated in about 10 to 15 moot court competitions. So to participate in 10 to 15 moot court competitions, having different problems and finding solutions for different problems is a huge an achievement within 5 years' time as a student. And that, in fact, gives you a lot of impetus to be a good lawyer, to prepare cases. And after preparation of the cases, how can you project a matter for a court? So before going to the court, in fact, you have got a sort of feeling of a court. And also, you know the strategy of moving a matter before the court. It is very important. I'll tell you one more thing. My daughter, who is also a lawyer, she has already 5 years of practice and doing, in my assessment, wonderfully well. I'm not telling at a father, but as a senior. They had to attend a moot court competition in Patiala. It is a national moot court competition. From Keat Law School, they had participated, and the team of the students who had been to Patiala, I find each one of them is having merit. And in the Patiala, I was not allowed to stay with them. I stayed in a hotel, and they had to stay in the accommodation. In fact, provided by the organizers. So they were the toppers in the round robin, you know, can you believe? They were the toppers in the round robin, and they qualified to the quarterfinals. And at the introductory speech, the dean of that university, I was really annoyed with that kind of approach. So dean of the university, he is saying there are so many students from national law universities and students from Symbiosis, and there may be students from other law institutions, and the students from national law universities will be having an edge over them. This kind of introductory speech he gave. Then my daughter told me, Papa, in fact, this is a demotivating factor to us. I said, don't worry. You have not come here to show your face. You have come here to face a challenge. I mean, to face a sort of to challenge and to achieve a goal. You do. You prepare, are you? And could you believe they were the toppers in the round robin, I mean, Key Law School. In the quarterfinal level, they were defeated by another. And I know I have been a judge in moot court competition. How the judges react, how the judges give marks, that I also know. So there is nothing wrong. In fact, to go to such a level in the national level of moot court. And there I used to always tell the younger generation lawyers, or to my interns. Let me tell you what I tell my interns. Right now I have got 5 interns. 3 from the National Law School, Cuttack, Odisha, and 2 from Symbiosis, Pune. All these 5 law students, they are wonderful. And probably these 5 interns are the best so far in my office. Whoever has come to for internship, these 5 are the best. I used to tell them, look, this legal profession is just like arithmetic. In the arithmetic, when you solve a problem, simplification, then you have to follow a principle, that is BODMAS, BODMAS. You first remove B, then remove D, O, then D, then M, A, then A, and then S is the solution. Similarly, every legal problem is like BODMAS. You go step by step. Go step by step. Remove a step, then go to other step. Remove that step, go to the other step. You ultimately reach the conclusion. And that is the analysis. That means then you have to first fix up a goal. The goal you have to achieve. When you are to achieve the goal, then you have to face a lot of challenges. Then the challenges are to be really faced. You should not run away from the challenge. If you run away from the challenge, then you will not be in a position to achieve your goal. Then while facing the challenge, you will be having a lot of fun. Enjoy that. That means coming to office is a fun. Working with the senior's instructions, it's a challenge. And the purpose for which you have come, it's a goal to achieve. You see, if you go like this systematically, ultimately with the conclusion, then there will be nothing better than that. So this is the
moot court. That's a very motivating answer to this particular question regarding the importance of moot courts that is given by you. Now this brings me to 2 other important questions that I would like you to ask you. The first one being that what would be your advice to those law students who couldn't make it to NLU but want to excel in their profession? Because there are a limited number of NLUs obviously in our country, and there are a lot of law aspirants and law students. So what would be your primary advice to them?
Don't get enamored by the name of the institution. What is more important is, after you complete your institution, I mean your course in the institution, you should try to get yourself admitted to a good law office. That is primary. Going to a particular good institution is not as primary as finding out a good law office for you to be a lawyer. And why should one go to a better institution? For a better infrastructure, for better faculty. You just tell me, what is a better infrastructure in a particular law institute other than providing journals, providing various law lectures? And if I probably don't see any law institute today which is not providing good journals, which is not providing good lectures, And every launch ticket today is having moot courts, number of moot courts in a particular year. There are number of participants. Can the Debashis believe in the Orissa Judicial Service? MS Law College has, the students have excelled. 60% of Millard, 60% of these successful judicial officers are from MS Law College. Is it a national university? It's not. The mindset of the students have changed. The students, as of today, students, they know what to read. They know where is the subject. They know how rich the subject. In fact, you did not have to go to a law library. You know how to reach a subject. If you reach a subject, if you have interest to read, then no question of going to National Law University or Symbiosis or anything of that sort. Gone are those days. Now every institution is equipped with good library, with good infrastructure, and in fact, good faculties. And what is a good faculty, or who is a good faculty? A good faculty nowadays in law colleges, who can bring the, in fact, students together, who can ensure that the students, they come to the college regularly, they develop a habit of coming to the college regularly, they develop a habit of going to the library, they develop a habit of reading the law journals. He is a good faculty. I would not rate a person as a good faculty who says, this is Section 8 of the Hindu Succession Act. This is Section 5 of the Hindu Succession Act. You read the journal, you will get to know what is Section 5, what is Section 8. And you go through the, now on a single, in fact, laptop, on a single command, you can find out so many things on Section 8. And as you rightly said now, you had no occasion to have any access to the judgment delivered by the Orissa High Court by Honorable Justice C.R. Das and Honorable Justice Pravat Patnaik with regard to the senior advocate conferment. You could read it from your website. So it is only, in fact, I would say that doesn't matter. It was at a given point of time when faculties are not available, when infrastructure is not available, when students from certain law colleges, universities were not getting, in fact, proper scope after they pass out the law classes. Now everything galore. I will never ever suggest a student to go to either law university if he, and should not be unhappy if he does, if he or she doesn't get a seat in the law university.
It was quite motivating to the students like me, Jyoti Prakash, and many others who are viewing this particular video and who hail from a traditional university or a state university rather, and not a good NLU or any other private college. So I hope this particular advice given by you will be adhered by all of us, including me and Jyoti Prakash, and will surely help us in boosting our morale and take up law as a career and and excel in that particular thing. Now, the second question that I was going to ask you was regarding internships. So what are the importance of internship, doing internships, and what are the qualities that you specifically see or check while hiring interns in your office?
Well, many, in fact, it has become a culture. Like you go to a renowned office, a well-known office, law office, get a certificate after 21 days that yes, you have done internship in that office. That will help you in your employment. Because whenever someone is going to give you employment, you will see where are the offices you have done your internship from. But I totally disagree with that. On the contrary, if you do internship with under a particular lawyer or under a particular senior advocate, then you should be sure of how much of interaction an intern can make with the lawyer or the senior advocate with whom he or she is going to do the internship. If for the heck of internship, if for the heck of getting a certificate, you go for 21 days and then obtain a certificate, or go 5-6 days and just get a certificate from the senior, that will not help the cause. Why I say these five interns who are doing internship with me just now, why I say so good about them because you know they are making my life difficult during this time, pandemic time. They are asking me every alternate day, sir, what do I read? What do we read? I give them topic, and every single day after, they would give me a. In fact, they could call me in the afternoon, sir. What is the time we should sit? And you know, every one day thereafter, there I am asking each one each one of them to tell me what she has read from the particular topic given, and what has she understood, and how much has she understood. If the intern is that much in the mind, no, I am going to an office to do internship. In fact, to know about what I had been studying in the college. Say, from the very first year, the students are coming for internship. On the very first semester also coming for internship, when they had very little, entry to the legal field. I would rather say they should start coming for internship from the third semester. Because in the first two semesters, they have completed some courses. If there is any doubt with regard to those particular courses, they will come and get those things clarified from the senior with whom they are going to have the internship. Either get those things clarified or read in the senior's office or with whom you are doing internship. The very course you are prosecuting in that particular semester. And alongside that also, you tend to know other, in fact, subjects in law, like constitution. Constitution is not in the first two semesters, not in the third semester also. It is in the fourth semester, I believe. If it is the fourth constitution, when is the parent of every law? I believe the constitution ought to have been taught in the very first semester itself. You don't teach the constitution in the first semester. You teach them in the fourth semester. But when supposing now contract is in the third semester. Now, in a contract matter, supposing there is a judgment of AIR 1986 Supreme Court 1571, or Central Water Inland versus Bajonath. In that case, it is not only with regard to the contract, but also with regard to Article 12, Article 14, Article 21 of the Constitution. So, you have to, in fact, the subjects of every semester should be analyzed in such a manner so that if someone is in second semester, then in the first semester, second semester, then he should have read something in the first semester which will help him to understand what he is going to read in second semester. But unfortunately, it has been done in such a way, the constitution is in the fourth semester. But in the third semester, you are going to teach them contract. You have to also teach them constitution. So this is the problem. And that intern, in fact, who is coming to a senior's office to do internship, he should keep that in the mind. Well, let it be in the fourth semester. In the third semester, I have the contract back. Okay, I'll go and ask my senior. Hey, sir, please, this is not what we have been taught. This is what we have been taught. Would you please explain to us? This is called true internship. Internship for the heck of internship, I don't appreciate.
Indeed, sir. We must do our internships seriously and with our whole hard work so that we can get much from that particular internship, because always seniors have a lot of things, a lot of experiences, a lot of knowledge to share with us. And if we don't go after those things, then obviously why a senior will tell those things from his will? So we have to do that. We have to extract that thing from our senior, and we must do that particular thing seriously with the internships that we tend to do. So this particular thing will surely help those who are viewing this video, and this will motivate them as to how to do internships and what are the pointers they should follow while interning under a senior's office. So now, sir, as you said that after passing out from Madhusudan Law College, you entered into doing LLM. So this brings me to ask you a question, that when did you join the bar, and what were your primary challenges? As you said that you were a first generation lawyer, so I presume that there would be a lot of difficulties in entering the legal field. So what were your turmoils, or what were the challenges that you have faced in your initial days, and when did you join the bar?
Well, there was no turmoil, in fact, I tell you. my first day in the court was 19th March 1984. That was the first day I did put on my robes and went to the court. And I was lucky enough that my senior entrusted me to do a very small matter before the Lao Zuma court, before the registrar court. And because my father was the friend, very close friend of my senior, that is the reason probably my sir had a little bit faith in me. So he wanted me to do a very small matter before the registrar court. But still then, sir told one of our, one of the senior colleagues in my office, he is Mr. Kunjabi Harikar. Sir told him, Kunjababu, you please be there in Chorjo. And he is going to do the first case today. See whether as to whether he is doing it in the rightful way or not. So this is a motivating factor from my from a senior or from the top of the top boss of the office. And in the profession, in fact, then it was a difficult proposition to earn in a few days, in first few days. You would not expect, or you can't believe, my income in first seven months. In first 7 months, my entire income was 25 rupees. And by then, if I had joined the Reserve Bank of India or Steel Authority of India or Postal Department, I would have drawn a salary of around 3,500 a month in 82, 83 rather. So it was not painful because there was a my mother was there to support me, and since I come from a family having a family nucleus, both financial and also social, and any kind of nucleus you talk about, my family had possessed that. But at a given point of time, the financial position had become very difficult, and so it probably would not have been a possibility to stand till a particular situation, if my elder brother, who is now residing in California, and if he had not financially helped me and my younger brother at that point of time, because he had joined State Bank of India by that time as a provisional officer. So finance was never a problem for us, initially from the parents and then from my elder brother. And thereafter, there are two, three lawyers of wide-range reputation. One of them was late Vibhuti Ratha, Vibhuti Bhushan Ratha. He's our neighbor in Cuttack. And the other gentleman is late Sri Gaurhari Panda, who was a retired district judge and the father of our Justice Sanju Panda. And late Mr. Rath and late Mr. Panda, they are extremely good friends. So I sometimes used to go to the office of Mr. Rath because it is very close by. In fact, for moot court competitions, when I had to take part, I used to go to his office. And sometimes after he used to come to our office, to our house in Cuttack. I remember still, it's not faint remembrance, but it is a quite loud remembrance. He said, while coming down from the first floor to the ground floor, he said, he called Papa, like, son, listen, in the legal profession, break is definitely to come in somebody's life. It is not that break will never come. It comes either sooner or later. That was his advice. Same also Mr. Gaurhari Panda's, Gaurhari Musa's advice. And Gaurhari Panda happened to be a friend of my father also. And in one of the cases from Jajpur, the clients wanted me to file the case, but they wanted to engage Mr. Gaurhari Panda to argue the matter and to guide me. As it was an election of a panchayat sarpanch, that matter. It was in 1984. So we Gaurhari Musa was staying probably then near Kannika Chak somewhere. He was staying there. So I went to him with the client and with the brief. So he studied that and he gave me dictation. I took dictation in his office. Then the client paid, I believe, at that point of time in 1984, probably he paid 2.5 thousand rupees to Bhusa to go take Mr. Gauri Rupanna, uncle. Can you believe? The entire money he gave to me. That entire 2,500 he gave to me. And these are the people who were there to, in fact, give me a motivation. Okay, break will come, don't worry. Once the break comes, there'll be no looking out, looking back. You know how the break came in my life? Then what happened is, for the first initially the first year, if I was not finding a chair in my senior's office, though there was a chair earmarked, but somebody else used to come and occupy my chair because I was not creating any problem. I was coming back and watching TV, then new black and white TV were coming. So I was watching Chitrahar and some other programs, or going to Cuttack Club to play badminton. That is what I was doing. From the second year, I had generated that interest when sir wanted me to do some cases in some courts. Dated by reading all the journals that were coming to my sir's office. And I was making note of those things in my note. In a particular matter with regard to grant of ad interim injunction, a judgment of our own High Court had come on a particular day. Say for the judge, say the judgment has come yesterday. I had read it last night. What I'm saying is absolutely, no exaggeration. The matter was there before Honorable Justice P.C. Mishra. And then arguing lawyer was late Mr. Ashok Mukherjee, senior advocate. And then the lawyer briefing him was late Akhilendra Kumar Mahapatra, who was also senior advocate, is no more. So they
sir, I think there is a disturbance. With the network from your side, I guess. It got disconnected, so we couldn't hear anything.
Okay.
You were saying about...
Let me repeat.
Ashok Mukherjee and... yes, sir.
In the court premises, in the court, in fact, they were confronted with certain questions, certain doubts which came to the mind of Justice Mishra. And they had no answer. So they were having discussion in the Munsi canteen in the Odisha High Court. So I was incidentally sitting there. I was listening to their conversation. And I told them, sir, this is what is reported in the yesterday's edition in the CLT, Cuttack Law Times. Then they showed that judgment and succeeded in getting the matter remanded to Puri Court. Right? And then between them, they decided that let Sorja go and argue in Puri Court. That was the break in my life. And that break came, of course, sooner in 1986-87. And thereafter, there is no looking back.
That's quite an interesting story to know about your breakthrough that came with the case
I had never a time of turmoil, nor I had any hazardous time, nor I had to really had to slog. Never has it ever happened. It was absolutely systematic. In a systematized way, you have to work, and we did not have slog, did not have to burn midnight oil every time.
Indeed, sir. So, sir, as you mentioned about this ad interim injunction case at around 1986, which gave you the breakthrough, I would like to know what was your experience in that particular case, because lawyers at that time say that in our first case, we knocked to the podiums and all. So was that severing thing with you or you were quite bit confident with the case, and how was your first case basically with that?
I was a very confident character, because by that time I was in the helm of affairs in my game, in my sports career. I was at the top of the world as far as the sports career was concerned. I was a state champion by that point of time. I had played so many matches. I had won so many matches even outside the state. So there was no fear. There was no, in fact, like shivering of the body or shivering of the head. That is the headshot. But there is one thing I should make it clear. Even as on today, till the time I opened the first word in the court, it is like while playing badminton, till the time the shuttle touches the racket for the first time, it's a bit nervous. But no sooner the shuttle touches the racket, then I am the king in the court. Similarly, till the first word comes up from my mouth, either your lordship or lordship, kindly hear me. These one, two words, once are uttered, I am the king in the court.
That's quite interesting to know that how was your first case and how you were quite confident with those arguments and the speech
And in that case, what happened is, when I went to argue before the Puri court, we succeed. I think we did not get the order before the first court. Then I think you have been muted. Then we had to carry an appeal, and the appeal was carried. And then Mr. C.R. Pal, who ultimately became the High Court Judge, Justice C.R. Pal, so he was the district judge then. So myself and Mr. Akhilendra Kumar Mahapatra, both of us, so I was the arguer. Again disconnected.
Yes, sir. It got disconnected again. No issues,
yes,
sir. We can
then he asked me to argue. And unprecedented thing happened in Puri court before the district judge. On one side, it is me and Mr. Akhilendra Kumar Mahapatra. I was having only 3.5 years of practice, and Mr. Mahapatra was having about 9 years of practice. On the other side, all the stalwarts of Puri court, Mr. Narayan Mishra, all were there appearing for the other side in Puri. And Mr. Bhakta Mishra was the leading, was the arguing counsel from their end. But the matter was argued out till 9:30 at night. And we were very, very confident of winning the battle, legal battle there, because we argued to our
it got disconnected, sir, I guess again. I would request attendees to wait for a while till then sir's network get back on track. We have a lot other important questions, including his advices for the young generation and young law professionals. So I would request all the attendees to stay tuned. He will join us back soon, and he will give his advice to us. So just stay tuned. Yeah. Yes, sir, he's back.
I'm sorry. In fact, there is some disconnection. Then at 9:30 we came back to the hotel, and at 10 o'clock at night we got an information that the judge, district judge, wanted to meet us. Devashish, I tell you, at that point of time we had a tremendous ego, and to be very honest, so we said, the gentleman who came to inform us that the district judge wanted to meet you, we said, tell him that we can't go. So we did not go, and the judgment went against us. Thereafter we engaged our senior in the High Court, and we succeeded here in the High Court, and then the matter went to Supreme Court. We also succeeded in Supreme Court.
That's quite interesting to hear. So if I will portray, then we should keep our egos aside when we yes, deal with exactly. The professional things.
Exactly. For a matter. Because once Justice Anand Patnaik, then in a rotary meeting, Justice Anand Patnaik said, everyone has his or her own ego. But the ego has to be controlled by you. You should not be getting controlled by the ego. What Justice Patnaik said, if you feel that ego is going to control you, you ask your ego, hey, please calm down. You are not to control me, I am to control you. But there must be someone to trigger that motion, because when you are on your toes and at the top of the world, then the ego is totally controlling you. Right? Then somebody should be there to trigger, tell him that, yes, please calm down, I am to control you, not you.
Absolutely, sir. Still, the attendees must always remember that ego in particular thing won't let us to do any good to our cases or whatever we deal with in our future things. So always we should keep ourselves moderated and calm and quiet, and do the things in the right way. So, sir, you have mentioned about a lot of legal luminaries from Odisha, and including late justices and senior advocates. I would like to know any specific instance with them or any lesser known facts about them that we as a younger generation should know, because there are a lot of names you have mentioned and I have kept in writing in my diary, but I don't know any of them personally or haven't seen them. So if you can tell us anything lesser known fact about them, or any good trait of their personality, or anything related to them which will benefit us.
See, there is no dearth of instances, and we had legends. See, in Odisha and in Odisha High Court, till 1980, there are basically three kinds of litigations. One is civil and revenue together, third is criminal, fourth is service. So these are the 3-4 types of cases we are coming. After that, you know, now everything you do today, everything that you do right from the morning till evening is being backed up by a legislation. So if everything that you do is being backed up by legislation, if while doing something some wrong is committed, then there is a litigation. So now the scope has expanded a lot, huge. And that scope earlier was there in Delhi, in Mumbai, because most of the Mumbai good lawyers are coming to Delhi. Because in Delhi, you see, all the tribunals were there in Delhi, and all high flying matters, important matters were in Delhi. So in Delhi, lawyers gradually, it felt that the lawyers then, Delhi was considered the lawyer's den. That is the reason so much of cases, High Court, Supreme Court, not many tribunals, not many appellate authorities, not many statutory authorities are in Delhi. So multifarious cases were being done in Delhi. That is why they are getting a lot of scope and to appear in various courts, various tribunals, but there was a limited scope as far as Odisha was concerned. But after this binding law, after the proliferation of many enactments and governing respective fields, Odisha has become also a den of the lawyers. And in Odisha, neither was there in the dearth of a good lawyer or a good senior lawyer, nor today there is a dearth of any good lawyer. And here we are, in fact, under the influence of, I want to say, it is a inferiority complex. The inferiority complex is not with the lawyers, it is with the clients. The clients feel probably someone from Delhi will give them a better result than someone from Odisha. Debashish, you will not agree. I mean, you will not, in fact, agree is not the correct word. Can contemplate now being the National Company Law Tribunal and many other important cases, lawyers from Odisha, practitioners from Odisha, they are in fact ruling the roost. Gone are those days. Now, I'll tell you another thing. A lawyer from Delhi was coming and he used to concentrate on one particular case. He, a senior advocate from Delhi, would be briefed by a group of lawyers. And then he used to, for the whole of the day or a couple of days, he used to read one particular brief. He is not only briefed by the lawyers, he also applies his own mind. Then the whole day he spends on one particular case. If that opportunity is given to me, I am not less competent than anybody else in the country. One case for 3 days. And why should I be less competent to anyone in the country? So that is the difference. And now since the result which has been given by the lawyers from outside, the very same result has been given by the lawyers in Odisha, the clients, they have understood that no, here there is substance. So when there is substance here, why should you go to a distant place? And names like late Ranjit Mahanti, I've never seen a witty lawyer like him. Late Sri S.S. Basu, late my senior Ramakanta Mahapatra, late Ravid Panit, late Gangadhar Ratha, names will galore. And thereafter, in the present generation also of the seniors, I can say at least 10 senior advocates are available. You can trust them. You can entrust them any case. For example, our former advocate general, Mr. Surya Prasad Mishra, he is a wonderful civil lawyer and extremely intelligent. The level of intelligence he possesses, it is unimaginable. Can you believe he has had very little practice in regard to the corporate law, company law? That is in fact my domain in certain, to an extent. We have a very, very cordial and nice relationship. Like Mr. Rajat Prat, myself, Mr. Rajat Prat is no more, who I consider him to be a wonderful lawyer. And if at all they had, well, if they could go through the statute, they can find out the solution. But they are being, having so much of cases to argue on the next day. So why not to ask Surjo, and if not Surjo can tell something, then they can go on that. So sometimes we discuss about the cases. Can you believe a person who has little practice in regard to corporate law, when he was given to argue a matter, corporate law matter before the court, he argued as if he is second to none. So we have to, in fact, find out the substance. And here, a lot of lawyers have been substance. Even many lawyers who have not been declared senior, they are doing wonderful. There is no dearth of lawyers, and the legal practitioners now in the state of Odisha, they are doing very well. But one thing is lacking. There is a B big gap between the people who are entering into and the people who have already attained a position. And I don't know why the gap is there and why it is increasing. But given an opportunity, or whenever given an opportunity, I will try to bridge the gap.
Indeed, sir, you have told us a very nice thing about the relationship between the lawyers with you and the members of the bar who are then the legends, like you said about Rajat Rath, sir, who passed away last year only, I guess, because I was also connected with him in some way. So yeah, you have mentioned a number of advocates whom we can obviously look up to and know about him, their history, the way they used to argue before the court and how they have applied their wit and knowledge to win various cases. So that's quite great of an answer given by you. Now, as we know that you have practiced for almost 36, 38 years in the bar, I would like to know that what all aspects of being a lawyer interests you, and what are the qualities that an advocate must possess within himself?
The first thing is discipline. That is most important for a lawyer. Discipline in your dress, discipline in your approach, discipline in your demeanor, discipline with regard to how much vocal you should be in the court. You know, Mr. Deepak Mishra, before he was elevated to the High Court, he was equally close to me. And before his elevation, he told me once, "Sorjo, you have got the quality to be a good lawyer, but one thing you are lacking is where to stop and how to stop." That means discipline in how much vocal you should be in the court. So discipline, a lawyer, if at all, is discipline in the dress, in the approach, in the demeanor, and how much vocal he should be in the court, then he is 50% through. Another 50% is his own preparation, study, and presentation in the court.
Indeed, sir, these two pointers should be remembered by everyone who is joining the bar and who is prepared to do or go for litigation. That discipline is a must for the legal profession. And we always should know as to where should we stop, how much we have to say before the court, and what we shouldn't say before the court. Because yes, these are the aspects that will take us to a long way. Absolutely, very correctly portrayed, sir. Now, this brings me to ask you two very pertinent and important questions relating to being a lawyer in doing litigation. The first aspect is about drafting. So what are the basic tips that you would like our audience to know about drafting, and what all common mistakes you have come across done by juniors of yours? And that should be rectified by our audience, including both me and Jyoti Prakash.
Well, in fact, drafting plays a major role, because any petition, if it's drafted properly, any petition, supposing is petition takes care of every aspect of a particular litigation, then you are presenting your facts in a very clear-cut manner before the court. So for that reason, two things are necessary. One is that you should first master the fact. The facts which are to be placed before the court, a note has to be prepared with regard to the fact, and that too it has to be a chronological note, date-wise. What happened at what particular point of time in a chronological manner. Then, once that is done, then 50% of the drafting is over. Then another 50% is the legal contentions. What would be the legal contentions in your draft? Then how can you know what would be a particular legal contention in a particular set of facts? That you gather by dint of your own experience and by reading the journals. This is my sincere request, appeal to all the younger generation, even to the entire legal fraternity, that they should be updated with regard to the recent development in law. What is the procedure or process to remain updated with regard to development, recent development in law is, a journal comes, supposing today to you at 4 o'clock in the evening, you finish the journal, there are about 5 to 6 judgments must be reported or 10 judgments reported. Read the journal and the ones which you think that they are your cup of tea, you note it down in your notebook. The others which you feel they are not your cup of tea, those things remain in fact imprinted in your software here. If that remains imprinted in the software here, supposing that is not your cup of tea, but you can come across a particular litigation which you want to present before the court, your factual narration is ready, then you could immediately recollect, okay, that is the judgment I had read, and this aspect which is to be projected before the court was dealt with in that particular judgment. Let us take out that book and let us see what has been decided by the court or what is the ratio decidendi in those cases, and just put those things as your legal contentions. That means your fact is ready. Legal contention you can know by reading journals, keeping in mind, keeping in the note. One facts are ready, you just add those legal contentions in tandem with the fact, then the draft is ready. And you should be very particular about the prayer you are going to make. The prayer portion is to be made very, very absolutely clear. Sometimes, you know, some judges, they are very strict about the prayer portion. Though there are not many judgments of the Supreme Court and various high courts that the judges can always bold the prayer. But still then, why should you leave something for the judge to tell you? Why should you not? I mean, while preparing a draft or making a draft, you should not leave any stone unturned.
Absolutely, sir. Even I have learned from doing internship under various chambers that while we draft our prayer, we should always put forth every contention, every relief that we are asking for, and should not leave anything, because that yes. cannot be amended at the later part of that proceeding per se. Yes. So we should carefully draft, and I am very sure that the pointers given by you regarding reading a particular judgment, keeping it with you, and reading the facts and clearly analyzing those facts, and clearly analyzing the law, and then combining it to make a proper draft will surely help our attendees. Now, the second aspect that I was asking you about is client satisfaction. Now, you have we are obviously sure that you have dealt with a number of clients. So, what is the importance of client satisfaction, and how a lawyer should handle a client and counsel a client on a particular case?
Well, now as a senior advocate, the honor was bestowed upon me on 26th of February 2013. It has become more than 8 years. After you become a senior advocate, you don't hold a brief for anyone. So the clients cannot have a direct access to us. They have to come through some instructing lawyer. See, the client detention, it's an art. There are lawyers who can retain the clients till the client is dead or till the lawyer is dead. That is an art. That art only many cannot acquire. It is an inborn quality of some human beings who become lawyers to retain clients. But client retention is not important. What is important is giving proper relief and guidance to the clients. If a person has come up with a problem, he wants a solution, and a lawyer says, okay, yes, whatever solution you desire or whatever result you want, I can provide you. But ultimately, once he approaches the court, so supposing he cannot or he could not provide the relief, the client will go. But at that point of time, but the client will instantly be happy, okay, whatever I wanted, my lawyer said, yes, sir, he will give me that order. That is the reason I always say, don't ever give a tailored opinion. whatever is correct in the eye of law, given opinion, or rendered opinion according to what you feel to be correct. And my reading may be different from somebody else's reading. If at all somebody, some client is dissatisfied with my assumption or my reading of a particular case, he is free to go and approach any other lawyer. Doesn't matter. I will take my fees for the purpose of giving my opinion. I have not taken a lease of somebody. Once I give an opinion, I should do his case till the time the case is disposed of. No. He has come to me for a particular purpose. I have satisfied the purpose to the best of my ability. Thereafter, it is up to the client whether to stick to me or to go to somebody else. I always say to people, says, for example, I give an example, 2-2 is equal to 4. It is plus 2 and into 2. Both become 4. In a given situation, the situation demands it should be plus. The client says, no, sir, please give an opinion that it should be 2 into 2. So the lawyer, supposing, gives an opinion, 2 into 2 is equal to 4. The client becomes happy. Okay, the lawyer has given an opinion. He goes and files a case, gets a big 0 in the order, dismissed. But somebody, if at all, they'll say, no, Mr. So-and-so, whatever you say, it may be, the result may be same, but this is not correct. Don't do that. And even don't go by what others say, because this is what is the law. And if it is a knowledgeable client, having little knowledge with regard to law, show him your analogy. Why you are saying this is what is correct? Why what he is contemplating is not correct? You give reasons to dislodge his own ideas. If you don't show reasons to dislodge his own ideas, definitely he will go by his own ideas. So don't ever give a tailored opinion to a client. Whether the client remains or not, doesn't matter. But you will lose your image before the court and before the client. And ultimately, it may so happen, you may have a short-term benefit, but long-term loss.
Indeed, sir. You have given great pointers regarding the client's satisfaction. Part and client, how we should counsel our client and what factors we should keep in our mind while dealing with our clients. So I hope this will help our attendees on this particular aspect. Now I would like to call upon Jyoti Prakash Datta, the co-founder of Lex Cognoscenti. He has prepared a certain set of questions which are quite important for law students and young legal professionals. So Jyoti Prakash, you may continue with the questions that you have prepared. The mic is all yours. And I would request all the attendees to stay tuned with this part of interview, because this will surely be interesting and will give a lot of knowledge and pointers to you for the part of legal profession and legal field, as we say. So Jyoti Prakash, you may continue.
Thank you, Devasis. I was listening carefully to your questions, and sir has answered very lucidly to all the questions, and I have learned a lot. As you were also noting down many points, I had also noted many points from the answers given by sir. So sir, you have already explained us as to what is the difference between senior advocate and a junior advocate, and you were also designated 8 years back as a senior advocate. So sir, my first question is, what is the difference in the approach of a senior advocate and a junior advocate? Like, if a case comes to a junior advocate, how he deals with that and how it is different from the dealing part of the senior advocate?
Jyoti, in fact, I would desist from the expression junior advocate. I would rather be happy to call them instructing lawyers. Right? Because under the Advocates Act, we have only advocates and senior advocates. There is no expression junior advocate. We'll say that they are the instructing lawyers. And see, the lawyers, the basic difference between a senior advocate and an advocate is, a senior advocate cannot directly discuss cases with the clients. He cannot give any opinion directly to the client. He cannot write letters to the client. He cannot draft anything for the purpose of presentation before the court. and he cannot also charge money directly fees from the client himself. There lies, in fact, a lot of responsibility with the conducting lawyer. When a client comes to a conducting lawyer, he has to first inquire from the conducting lawyer the instructing lawyer, as to whether he wants the case to be conducted by him or by his senior advocate. So he has to make this aspect clear from the client himself. If the client says, no, you please go ahead, you conduct the case, then he should go ahead in conducting a case. And there are senior advocates available in our state, including Surja Sundar Das. I make one thing very clear, that we are not Shylocks, we are Antonios. And whenever, supposing a young lawyer or an instructing lawyer finds difficulty in making a proposition clear before the court, or making a proposition loud and clear before the court, he can always look towards us. And without any hesitation, if we are there inside the court, we can come to his aid and assistance. That is what is the duty of a senior advocate. A senior advocate owes a lot of responsibility toward the judges, toward the younger generation, toward the instructing lawyers, toward the other lawyers, toward the clients, toward the nation, and towards the law, towards everything. When a senior advocate appears in the court, he appears with a different, in a different manner. They'll be looked upon in a different manner. The judges, the lawyers, they expect a lot from them. If a senior advocate cannot afford to, or can ill afford to, in fact, say something wrong, either factually or, in fact, legally. I tell you one thing, what happened in one of my cases, Mr. Gautam Mishra, now who is also a senior advocate, then he was not declared senior. He was arguing a matter before Honorable Justice S.K. Mishra. And about 3-4 days before, I had argued a matter of having a similar position of law as to with regard to the precedent value of the Supreme Court judgment under Article 141 of the Constitution, right? So, in fact, I had argued a matter before the Honorable Justice Mishra. The very same thing Mr. Gautam Mishra was trying to advance before the court. And it is a sheer coincidence that I was entering into the court, into that very court. I had a matter later on. I was sheer coincidence. I just entered into, just to know what is the matter going on. So when I could hear Justice Mishra telling Mr. Gautam Mishra that Mr. S.S. Das was arguing like this in a matter a few days back, then when that reached my ear, I went to the front and I appealed to the court. Since I am there in the court, let me explain what was the position with regard to Article 141. It's a case reported in AIR 1995 Supreme Court, page 1480. There, the Supreme Court said, the language is, the Madhya Pradesh High Court did something which a co-equal bench of this court could not have done. That is the language used. Then I explained to the court, and Mr. Gautam Mishra, I still remember Mr. Gautam Mishra said, yes, my lord, this is the language used in the judgment. Then I that the feeling, the satisfaction in the face of Justice Mishra. He said, that is why we have bestowed the honor of senior advocate on Mr. Das. So this is what a senior advocate carries in the court. We are to assist the court in a matter, even if we are not there. S.S. Das may not be there in a particular court. If some legal discussions are taking place and discussions are going in a different way rather than the way it has to go, as a senior advocate, that is my responsibility to notice of the court. Now, this is what is the law laid down. I should tell the conducting lawyer, Mr. Swenson, please listen. This is what is the law. That is what is a senior's responsibility. Because the senior holds no brief for anyone. If the senior holds no brief for anyone, then he is always a friend of the court, he's a friend of the litigants, he's a friend of the lawyers, he's a friend of everyone. He can't make a distinction between X, Y, or Z. everyone is sent before him, unless he appears in a particular case. I think I'm clear.
Indeed, sir. Indeed, sir. That was a great advice, sir. And the best thing that I derived from this advice is that seniors are regarded very high in our society, and not in only in court but also in our society. And junior lawyers look forward to learn from senior lawyers, and senior lawyers should conduct their behavior according to the ethics and morality. And this particular instance also reminded me another fact that I had read some days ago. One day, Justice M.C. Chagla, former Chief Justice of Bombay High Court, was presiding over the bench, and there was a tax dispute, and a hearing was going on. Some advocates were appearing before Justice M.C. Chagla, but they were not able to solve that particular reference, and there was some dispute and which could not be addressed by any of the advocates. So Justice M.C. Chagla referred that matter to the great Jamsetji Kanga, who was not appearing for any of the parties, but still he assisted the court because he considered that it is the duty of the senior advocates to assist the court even if there is no particular matter of their own. So that is a great point that you have also conversed, sir. Sir, another thing that I want to know from you, that you are also designated as senior advocate, and there are also times when many other legends of the bar were designated as senior advocates. And today there is, as you said earlier, that there is a race among the advocates to become senior. So, sir, what do you find? What is the difference in designation of senior advocate? What is the difference in the processes that were followed earlier and that were followed in your days and now? What is the difference in the approach? As we know, as also you mentioned, that Indira Jai Singh case is there, and there are some guidelines provided by the Honorable Supreme Court in that particular case. And after that, our Odisha High Court also framed a rule in 2019 for designation of senior advocates. So what is the basic difference between the approaches, and what is the basic difference between the processes that were followed earlier and during your days and now?
See, during our days, there is no specific procedure followed for bestowing the honor on the lawyers. Long back, in fact, when our seniors, my senior was honored with the honor of senior advocate, they are all, in fact, requested by the bench, by the judges, to accept senior advocacy, which was the practice. I think it was the practice till early 90s or late 80s. Thereafter, in fact, the scenario has got changed. And the lawyers who wanted to be senior advocate, they had to make application to the Chief Justice, to the registrar, to become senior advocates. There was no codified rule or the codified procedure to, in fact, choose as to who to become, to who to honor, bestow the honor. That is why at different points of time, different modalities were adopted. And that is also the reason for which at different points of time, some of the advocates who have been designated senior, they could not become senior on the first couple of occasions. And I was a victim also for one occasion. Though I had applied, but I was not considered to become a senior advocate. I don't know what was the demerit I had at that point of time. But subsequently, in fact, I applied and became a senior advocate. It was well accepted by all. And what was not accepted about 8 to 9 months back was again accepted after 8 to 9 months back. So there was no codified procedure. That is the reason this kind of things were happening. And similarly, in our country, there was not a single, in fact, procedure followed to confer this honor upon the lawyers. In various states, different procedures were being adopted. And that is the reason you will find many of the lawyers practicing in Delhi having very few appearances here in Odisha, where in fact conferred the honor of senior advocates from the Odisha High Court itself. Then Mrs. Indira Jai Singh, with whom I am very closely in fact associated, she has come, not only that, I'm associated, she has also come to my office on a number of occasions in Cuttack. And she in fact had filed a PIL before the Honorable Supreme Court that let this senior advocate sort of thing be abolished. But ultimately, when the matter was being argued, that very same, that very prayer for what initially was prayed for was took the back seat. And what was argued as to who should be conferred with the honor? Not that every Tom, Dick and Harry can be honored as a senior advocate. That is the reason Supreme Court said, you know, the language is, it is bestowing the honor of senior advocacy on a particular advocate. The language is bestowing the honor. That is the Supreme Court carved out few guidelines. And you know, for the purpose of making someone a senior advocate, there is nothing in the Advocate Act of what is the, how he has to be declared. There is no procedure also laid down. So there is a vacuum. So when there was a vacuum and the matter went to Supreme Court, then in my conscious view, Supreme Court, by exercise of the power under Article 142 of the Constitution, framed a certain guidelines and which became the law of the land till the time a procedure or something is made by the legislature that remains as the law of the land. When the law of the land is supposing a particular thing, then Orissa High Court in the administrative side could not have done something different out of the law of the land declared by the Supreme Court. That is the reason the division bench comprising of Justice C.R. Das and Justice Ramana Patnaik, they held that particular clause in the Orissa High Court that senior advocate rules to be unconstitutional, ultra vires. So they have struck down that particular provision to be ultra vires because that was not within the guidelines set out by the Supreme Court. And that is what is all about the conferment of the honor of senior advocate on a particular lawyer. And my sincere, in fact, appeal to all those who are aspiring to be senior advocates, they should read this judgment of the Honorable Justice C.R. Das and Honorable Justice, and in the case of Indira Jai Singh. And what Honorable Justice C.R. Das, speaking for the bench, has said, the bench expects certain things from a particular lawyer. He should be a towering personality. That is the language used. He should be a towering personality. That means whenever a judge or the court or the lawyers or whoever looks at him, there must be having a solution with him, and the solution, not a lopsided solution. The solution which is in conformity with the act, with the rules, and with the regulations.
Indeed, sir, that is a very important judgment, and many important things have been highlighted in the particular judgment, especially the guidelines provided in the Indira Jai Singh judgment. Mm-hmm. And I think that was a particular wrong that was committed by the registry. By not adhering to the rules that has been already framed by the Supreme Court. And that's why Rule 6 of Rule 9 of the Orissa High Court designation of senior advocate rule was struck down recently. I think each and every viewer who are watching us will go through that particular judgment. If possible, we will also add that particular judgment in the video description. I think everyone should go through that particular judgment. So thank you for enlightening on that part, sir. And another thing that I want to know, sir, that you have already described about many legends and doyens of the bar, and also you have highlighted several other judges like Justice Dambarudhar Pathak and several other justices of our Honorable High Court. Sir, we have also seen many cases have gone to the Supreme Court from our High Court, and there are several other important cases which are pertaining to state of Odisha. So, sir, do you remember any such cases which should be known to all, especially the students who are pursuing law in Odisha? Which are those cases which hailed from our own state and went up to the Supreme Court and became landmark ones?
Yes. In fact, there are any good mining judgment. Any good mining judgment you will find from all are from Odisha. Like right from 1982 Supreme Court, like with regard to the grant of largesse of the mines leases, from 1982 onwards, all those important cases are from Odisha. And the last of the important cases, in fact, which went from Odisha and which is the law of the land, is the legal battle between the Imphals and the Tatas, which ultimately culminated in Supreme Court, which got a grant of Cromite lease. That is a judgment probably in the year, finally delivered in the year 1992. And there are, you will find wonderful judgments with regard to bank guarantee. Let me tell you one aspect, case, and anecdote also, alongside that case. You know, prior to commitment to bring of this Arbitration and Conciliation Act 1996, there were three arbitration laws governing the field. I don't know whether you know this or not. There were three enactments. One is the Protocol Act, other is the Arbitration Act 1940, another is Foreign Awards Recognition and Enforcement Act 1963. These are the three enactments with regard to arbitration. With regard to arbitration inside the country, arbitration, international arbitrations. So all the acts were in fact operating in their respective fields. So we were concerned about a particular enactment, the 1963 Act. And in that particular, that is a case between ICCL, Indian Charge Corp Limited, which ultimately got merged with Indian Metals and Ferroalloys. Indian Charge Corp Limited versus ASSIA Stal ABB. It's a case which in fact went from the Odisha High Court, and the judgment was delivered by Honorable Justice Sarathendra Mahapatra. There are two judgments. One is a judgment with regard to injunction on bank guarantee. That is the case which was argued by Mr. Soli Surabji. Then the other case is with regard to the interpretation of the provisions of the Foreign Awards Recognition and Enforcement Act. That was argued by Mr. Venugopal, Mr. K.K. Venugopal. And let me tell you about first what happened with regard to this 1963 Act and Mr. Venugopal. You know, in that case, lawyers from Delhi, they had come to really brief, in fact, Mr. K.K. Venugopal. And locally, we were two, myself and our former Advocate General, Mr. Sudhir Prasad Mishra. And if I remember correctly, there was an interpretation to be given to Section 7 of that Foreign Awards Recognition and Enforcement Act. Mr. Mishra and I, I hadn't had a car at that point of time. So Mr. Mishra and I were going together in this car. We used to travel at 9 o'clock in the morning for discussion, conference and preparation of the briefs, and come back at 4 o'clock in the morning. Can you believe? 9 o'clock in the morning. 4 o'clock. That means working for not on a single occasion, on many occasions. So while, in fact, when both of us, Mr. Mishra and I, were going in his car, we used to discuss about the niceties of that particular case. We discussed about Section 7. Then when we discussed about Section 7, then we discussed with our counterparts from Delhi, lawyers from Delhi who had come, but they simply brushed aside our views. They said, no, it is not applicable. Then Mr. Mishra and I, again, we are not satisfied with what they said. A discussion was being held in Hotel Oberoi in Chilka Suite. And Mishra and I were still discussing, pondering over the issue. Then Mr. K.K. Venugopal could find out that we are discussing something. Then he said, yes, you are discussing something, you have to say something. Then we said, sir, this is what we had discussed about Section 7, and we think we have a point. Then Mr. Venugopal went through Section 7. You can't believe that was one of the, I mean, at that point of time, just think of the feeling of the youngest lawyer in the team. Right? I felt as if I was the top of the world. Mr. Venugopal read the particular section and said, okay, I am going to argue this point first tomorrow. So, and this is what is the greatness of the great lawyers in the country. And thereafter, Mr. Venugopal argued that point next day in the court. And ultimately, we succeeded. We succeeded here before in the Odisha High Court. The matter went to Supreme Court, but Supreme Court held otherwise, by saying that filing a time petition in a suit to submit his written statement is not a step in the proceeding under the 1963 Act. And the judgment was delivered by I think, Justice Jagadishan Dayal, who died thereafter. While in Harness, he died. So this is with regard to that Section 9 application. So this is a case from Odisha. Then Mr. Solis Surabdi had argued the matter, that is with regard to bank guarantee injunction. Bank guarantee injunction at that point of time was a rare commodity to get from the court. By 1991-92, there was only one judgment, UP Cooperative judgment, 1984 Supreme Court. And UP Cooperative is the only judgment where the court granted injunction or bank guarantee. On two extreme circumstances, we had to bring our case within those two extreme circumstances to get a bank guarantee injunction. Because Solis Surabdi was fantastic in the court. He, in fact, was unstoppable. He could establish a link by showing all the factual aspects together that we were falling under those two categories to get an order of injunction. That ultimately went to Supreme Court, and Supreme Court held against us. These mining cases, Infa Tata, they are the cases of high importance, national importance, as far as mining laws, MMDR Act is concerned, in the whole of the country. And in fact, there is another case with regard to cess on mineral. Cess on mineral, that was the matter which I argued. I argued, I took a risk and I argued the matter. It was the ORIP tax that was challenged. And we also succeeded, matter went to Supreme Court. In Supreme Court, we succeeded, the SLP was dismissed. There are not many cases where I was involved, and the cases I've got from our High Court and to Supreme Court, and those are the landmark judgments. Still hold the field.
Indeed, sir, that is great to know that you have argued so many cases, and we are proud of the fact that our many senior advocates from state of Odisha, including you, have argued so many important cases which have gone up to the Supreme Court and have also laid down some laws which are prevalent till now. So, sir, the next question is about the trait of judgment reading. I could see that you can recite all the judgments with their citations. You mentioned about AR 1982 SC 818 and many other cases. So It shows that how you were thorough about those judgments and their citations in those days. So what should be the approach?
With regard to that, I'll tell you one thing. You said I remember all the things. What is your name? Tell me. What is your name?
Jyoti Prakash Datta.
How do you remember your name? Similarly, the way you remember your name, Jyoti Prakash Datta, similarly, we have remembered the cases. You come to my level, you will very well, you can remember all those things. It's nothing superhuman. The way you have remembered your name, in the very same way, you can remember all the cases. It's nothing superhuman.
Indeed, sir. That is something extraordinary, sir, because you remember those cases even after four decades. That is something very inspiring, because our names are in our mind because we use it frequently. But I don't think you use those cases frequently, but still you remember those names. That is extraordinary, sir. That is extraordinary. So, sir, the recent generation is not like that, and we are not reading the judgments from reporters. Mostly, we are reading from SCC Monopatra or Indian Canon, or for the matter, like Live Law and Bar and Mains. So, what should be the advice from you, sir? How to read judgments?
I tell my daughter and my younger brother, who is also an established lawyer, I told at the very threshold. None of them, neither my brother nor my daughter, they are following me. Right? I tell them repeatedly. Whenever a journal comes, you read the journal. You finish the journal on the very same day. It is not that from 6 o'clock in the evening till 11 o'clock in the evening, all the 5 hours, you are only reading the briefs and reading something. You must be having a couple of hours with you. So utilize those couple of hours for reading the journals and make a note of it. That will help you immensely.
Indeed, sir. You can cite so many cases, and you have read so many cases. So no matter whether it comes to our use immediately, but it can come to use in the future. So it should be read by everyone. So, sir, another question that I want to ask you, that we are not unknown to the importance of foreign judgment, sir. Sir, we have seen that in the past, Supreme Court has passed many important judgments like right to privacy case, Aadhaar judgment, and homosexuality case, where foreign judgments were used heavily. And as we know that those judgments are not binding upon our courts, but still they have some persuasive value. So, sir, do you think we should read all those foreign judgments as well?
Yes, why not? The reason, see, what is a judgment? A judgment is that what two sides of lawyers, the lawyers of two sides, they argue. The judge has to listen to both, judges have to listen to both sides, then strike a balance. And they have to draw an analysis. So it may so happen, see, which judgments are being followed or some persuasive values are there in our courts. English judgments, American judgments. Basically, the American have Supreme Court judgment and the English judgments are accepted. But the simple reason, our constitution is an excerpt from the English constitution. And the American constitution and our constitution are almost similar. So, there is nothing wrong in looking at the analysis which has been prescribed or subscribed by a judge of another high court or another Supreme Court. When the constitutional framework of that country and our country are almost same. And if you look at the constitutional framework, the facts involved in the cases, and the analysis subscribed, if that analysis is applicable in the facts of the case in our country, why not to be accepted? They are just bringing this analysis, if that analogy, that analysis, if that is correct in view of the judges who are deciding the matters, there is nothing wrong in accepting the analysis or analogy.
Indeed, sir. And I can remember Justice A.P. Saha, Chief Justice, who was the then Chief Justice of Delhi High Court, while deciding the Nash Foundation case, also relied upon Loving versus Virginia and Roe versus Wade, all these American cases, and yes. Found some substance from all those cases, sir. That is a very, very great advice, sir. I would also like everyone to read all those judgments, because that is very much important. We can also use to persuade the court to go in our favor if there is a vacuum in Indian laws. So,
yes,
sir,
you see there are cases. There are cases with regard to libel and slander. You see, in our country, how many cases on libel and slander will get? On the contrary, in regard to libel and slander, you will find a number of judgments from the English courts. That is why we sometimes, most of the times, we follow All England Reporter in cases of slander and libel.
Indeed, sir. There are so many cases about tort, especially on tort. There are so many foreign cases we till date follow in our courts. Yes, sir. And sir, the next question is something unconventional, and that is not particularly related to your journey in the bar, but I want to ask something different from all this context. Sir, you have been in the bar for last 4 decades, and before that you were also a student of Law College, Madhusudan Law College. So, sir, do you have any regret that you couldn't do while you were a student in your law college? And if you will be given a chance to study law again in the Madhusudan Law College, you will be doing that particular thing. Do you have any regret?
No regret at all. I am proud to be a student of my school where I have read. I am proud to be a student of the colleges which I have gone. And that is why it is called alma mater. It means nourishment of mother, mother's nourishment. The places where I have got my mother's nourishment, can I ever regret?
Indeed, sir. And we also must respect our alma mater, because no matter how small colleges are, how small colleges we read in, but those are very valuable, because whatever we are because of that particular alma mater. And apart from that, sir, I want to know whether whether you pursue any other hobby. You have also mentioned that you are a badminton champion in your younger days. So do you have any other hobbies till date apart from law?
Yes. Badminton was my everything. At a given point of time, it was like I have achieved a lot in badminton. And you know, when I retired from badminton, it has come out in the newspaper. And Honorable Justice Sarachandra Mahapatra read it. And he said in the court, "Mr. Das, why did you retire from badminton?" And he was sitting in division bench with Honorable Justice P.C. Mishra. And he told Justice Mishra that Surjo has retired from badminton. Justice P.C. Mishra said, "I could hear that." "But yes, I know." And badminton has given me a lot of things in my life. My father was a state football player. My brother, he is no more, my second brother, he was a wonderful football player and a cricket player. My immediate elder brother, who stays in California, he had played for the state of Odisha under-19 in cricket. And my eldest brother is a good table tennis player. And the youngest one, he plays all. And other than the games, because we all sit together. In fact, when there is a game taking place, we all sit together before the in front of TV, and we shout as if it's a shout of a mad character. It's like that. And other than sports and games, in fact, I love music. I love gardening, and I love to spend time with my family members, especially with my wife, my children, my brother's children, and my mother, who is in fact instrumental to bring me to this profession. We spend time whenever she is here. Mostly she remains in our village, because she has to still, at the age of 88, she still she feels she is a part of our village, and she is not interested to come here. So whenever she is here, I want to spend some time with her, and that is how we spend time.
Indeed, sir. We have been through your social media profile. We have seen you are connected with your motherland, and there are so many things that we have to learn from you. And another thing, sir, you should not retire from badminton, because you are almost 61, 62, but still you are like 35 or 40. So you should continue.
I am not retired. Every day in the evening, we play 3 games. From 6:30 to 7:30, we play 3 games.
That is inspiring, sir. And you should also continue for the infinite time, sir. We think that is very much inspiring, and the younger generation would also get some inspiration from that. And sir, the last thing that I want to ask you, sir, apart from all these hobbies and apart from reading law books and law reports, do you read all other books like autobiographies or biographies or any other books of history or culture?
I don't want to waste my time on those books, because reading law books are more important for me rather than reading other books. But there are certain books which in fact help us to be good human beings. Like I can tell you one book, that is the monk who sold his Ferrari. If it is a book of that much of substance, I would love to read that book, because that builds up someone's character. So any character building book, I would love to read, alongside the law books.
Indeed, sir. There are several self-help books, and we should read that and should inherit all those good qualities that are inherent in these books. And sir, the last thing that I want to ask, and many other viewers are also asking us to ask you, that what should be your advice to all the younger members of the bar, as well as the young law students, who are especially first-generation lawyers, or who are going to be the first-generation lawyers? How should they approach the bar, and how should they conduct their behavior in the initial days of the war? And apart from that, how would they get their first breakthrough? And what should be their first reference, corporate or litigation?
This is what I had already spoken when the Bashis in fact was getting some clarifications from me. But it is a $1 million question in today's scenario. It all depends upon somebody's approach. The younger generation, I would always tell them to assess the situation. When you enter into law classes, don't jump into a conclusion from the very first year as to you are studying law for this particular purpose. You see, as I said, when we were studying law, we were studying it for a particular purpose. There was no other purpose available. But now there are not many avenues open. So don't, in fact, get your entire destination fixed so early. Try to create a space for yourself. Space for yourself means a space whether in the litigation or whether a space in corporate or a space in joining judiciary or a space in doing something else where law and legal aspects take a major part to play. So if you are a young student, make it flexible, allow the space to continue, and the space will be occupied on the fourth or the fifth year. And on the fourth and the fifth year, whoever is there today in today's meeting, if at all seeks my advice, I would be free to in fact provide this advice without any hesitation. And with regard to the young lawyers who have joined the profession, I would always request the younger generation to be disciplined and in fact to follow the senior's advice, not to run after money. Money will automatically run after you at a given point of time. But and never ever try to dupe a client, never ever try to get purchased by the other side, and never ever try to in fact get influenced by the other side. And when you are entering into the courtroom as a lawyer, then always keep in the mind, all is fair in love and war. It is a legal war, it's a legal battle you are fighting in the court. While doing a legal battle in the court, all is fair in the sense, all fair things are fair. Don't adhere to unfair means. Unfair means will bring short-term benefit, but that will have a long-term negative impact upon your entire career.
Indeed, sir, you have filtered the court. It is always said that everything is fair in war and law, but you have filtered that all fair things are fair and not all things are fair. And that should be adhered to by each and everyone. And often it is said that we can lose a particular case, but we should not lose the judge because he is going to judge us for many days and also for decades.
I'll tell you one thing.
Yes.
It's a loss or a failure. That should be erased from the dictionary of a lawyer. A lawyer should never think of a loss or a failure. Supposing a verdict goes against him, he should take it as an experience. It's not a failure. It's not a loss. If at all, he thinks it's a failure. If he thinks it's a loss, then he is getting caged, imprisoned by the past. And he's spoiling his present and spoiling the future. He can't be an architect of your future. You can only be an architect of your future if you think the failure as an experience, that by doing this, I could not achieve. If I do that, I will achieve. You gain experience and then become an architect of your future. And one thing, that don't lose a judge, don't even lose a case. Well, that is said in a very lighter way. It's better, it's always said earlier, a good lawyer is he who knows where the law is. Now it is said, a good lawyer is he who knows who the judge is. It is sometimes it is being misplaced. But what is the real meaning is, whenever I have seen, whenever lawyers from outside, from Delhi, they were coming and I was assisting those senior lawyers, they were trying to know how the judge is, in the sense whether he is very, in fact, smart to catch points, or he is little slow, or a judge wants to delve into the factual aspect first, or the judge would like to go into the legal aspect first. So this is what they want to know from the local lawyer, what the judge is, what kind of judge he is. So that is why it is said who the judge is. That means what kind of character he possesses. If he, supposing the judge is a very sharp judge, and if you start arguing from the very grassroots, the judge will get annoyed. What are you arguing? You are arguing, you will say once. I'll tell you, in fact, I don't think I'm doing anything wrong. Once I was arguing a matter before a division with one of the judges, he said, not knowing me, you are arguing like a trial court lawyer. Then immediately, though that impacted me for the few seconds, but immediately I could get back to my senses by saying, no, if I react, then what is going to happen? If I react, then the client is going to suffer. Who is not? Who is behind? I know what I am. I know what I am arguing. So why did I get such a, in fact, comment from the concerned judges? I was not knowing what the judge is or what kind of argument he wants to hear. So I argued only keeping in view the senior judge. I know the senior judge very well. If the senior judge wanted, the senior judge before whom this matter was there, division matter was there. I know what the senior judge is. So I started arguing like that, and not knowing what the other judge is. It was new. So I was confronted with such a kind of question which I had never heard in my 38 years of career as a lawyer. So that was my mistake. I should have known who the judge is, what kind of argument he wants to, who he appreciates. Without knowing what kind of argument he appreciates, really, I had argued in a way I argue. So I had to answer that. I had to listen to this. This happened only in the last year. At this 37th year of practice, I had to hear it. I had to swallow it. It was my mistake. I was not knowing what kind of judge he is. So now it is said, a good lawyer is he who knows who the judge is. I should have known that before making the submission.
Indeed, sir. And the comment that you argued like a trial court lawyer, that is actually not a criticism, that is actually a compliment, because after practicing so many years in the higher courts, you have acquired the skills of a trial lawyer. That is also a compliment in itself.
Of course. I don't deny it, because there are all the two sides of a coin.
Indeed.
And you are quite intelligent to have the other side of the coin.
Indeed, sir. That's great of you, and sir, you have also very lucidly pointed out that we have to know the approach of the judge. We should not personally connect it with the judge, but yes, we should know what is the approach of the judge and what is his philosophy. And for example, if a judge is a reluctant one, he is a traditional one, he is not a person who is trained to accept the modern views, we should know the approach and philosophy of the judge. And I think that will be very helpful to all our viewers. And sir, it is really indeed a pleasure to have a pleasant personality like you for this interview session. And you described everything in a very lucid and brief manner. We have asked many questions to you, and you answered every question in a brief manner, because all these answers could have been very long, but you answered everything in a very brief and short manner. You described about your childhood days, you described about your initial days in the bar, and you have also explained about the great doyens of the bar. Apart from that, you have also described the older day judges and what are the important cases that have arisen from our own high court and have gone up to the Supreme Court, and many other anecdotes. And I really value those anecdotes, because those are the things that we will not get to learn anywhere else than from experienced lawyer like yours, of your statute. So I would now request our co-founder, Mr. Devasis Kumar Panda, to come on the screen. And as I have already told that it is a very great session. It is a very great session, and many things we could learn from this particular session. And I will definitely treasure this particular session, and I will definitely watch this particular session more than once, because I want to grasp all those personalities and their experiences, because that is going to help me in the future days. So Devasis, I would request you to please give the formal vote of thanks to our honorable guest.
Thank you, Jyoti Prakash, for briefing out the things that we have covered in today's session with sir. On behalf of Team Lex Cognoscenti and Jyoti Prakash Datta, I would really like to thank you for consenting to this particular interview. And we are really grateful for having a person of your stature in today's session who gave a lot of important pointers and a lot of anecdotes which we couldn't have gathered from anybody else other than you. We gathered a number of names we didn't know earlier from you. We could know the names of the justices at your time, at your early age of your practice, and the who were the doyen of the bars at that time, who were doing great. So it was quite a wonderful session in that particular aspect of knowing anecdotes of a lot of things, and how you assisted Soli Sarabji in a case and then KK Bhanukabal in another case with SP Mishra sir. So it was quite inciting and a pleasure to know from you all these things. And then you have also pointed out a great important points regarding drafting and client counseling and various other aspects regarding moot court, internships, and the advices that you gave to our audiences and young generation lawyers. So we are really grateful for having you on board with us today's evening, and we are really humbled that you have spared more than 2 hours of your valuable time from your busy schedule today to the team of Lex Cognoscenti and me and Jyoti Prakash. So we are really grateful, sir, and we are really humbled and obliged.
Thank you so much. In fact, I have not wasted my time. I have utilized my time in a fruitful manner. So I also learned a lot from both of you. And the way you presented the entire thing is something I have to learn. I couldn't have done at your age also. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to meet people through this virtual mode. And I wish you go ahead with your mission to achieve whatever you want to achieve. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.